You are now listening to The Project.
To The Project.
To The Project. Where we stop at nothing to bring you the right facts on health, fitness, and psychology. Featuring some of the world's most experienced professionals. So you can learn, lift, and live. With your hosts, Mank, Dr. D, and Mehdi.
You can't overstress your body. You do that, it's just a recipe for disaster. You have to look for what is going to be sustainable over a 30-day or a 28-day period.
It's a month, and so within this month, you can have multiple little things that you want to keep, like maintaining a schedule and making sure that you're being a bit more mindful while you're eating. And I think all these little things are just going to eventually add up and make for a better experience.
We really need to enjoy, because there are going to be people that we might have Ramadan with this year that we might not have them the next Ramadan. Or there are people that are already have gone from our life that we didn't really take the time to enjoy being with them.
All this and more in today's episode.
Hey, everybody. Barak alaykum ash-shahr. Happy Ramadan. Happy Ramadan.
Happy Ramadan.
Ramadan.
Ramadan. Oh my God. Hay is cracking jokes. This is going to be a good episode.
It's going to be a great episode.
You, Dr.
She's often more funny than you are anyway.
Oh, snap. That.
I do get more listens.
That is actually very true. Hay does get the most downloads. Like whenever we put Hay's name on, she gets the most downloads and the most comments.
But you know why?
Why?
Because I pick on you.
Oh.
And you can't say anything back to me.
Well, you pick on... Oh, no. So now you and Dr. D are going to pick on... Hey,
yes.
Told me I had to go see a shrink the other day.
100%.
100%.
100%.
I told you to go see that, you know, what was her name? The Rhonda woman. And you...
She's not a shrink. She's a juju lady.
You just need help.
The energy can help you there.
Anything will help you.
Oh my God.
I've been recommending it for a while, Heya.
I completely agree. Oh, can this be Mehdi's intervention episode?
No, this is Ramadan episode. This is supposed to be about Ramadan.
I tried to do intervention the other day, Heya. It doesn't work.
Okay.
No, but I figured out it was guilt and feelings of, you know. So no, we came a little down. Like we went deep.
Oh, wow.
Of guilt. Yeah.
Okay.
It was all the open stuff.
It was all, and in Arabic, can you imagine?
Wow.
Ana hassas, which means I'm sensitive to all of our English listeners out there.
There's nothing wrong with being sensitive, but you should channel it in a positive way.
Speaking of sensitivity, we're moving into Ramadan. It's our second year of coronavirus. Most likely Kuwait is going to be in a full lockdown or partial lockdown again. The rest of the world is starting to open up except for us, and people are going to have to open their souls during the holy month of Ramadan, and they're going to also open up their ideas of going into crash diets and changing and whatever. So,
and their sleep.
Yeah.
Their sleep is going to be very changed, and their mood is going to be very, very hard to handle. So I never thought that this... It's going to be the second Ramadan where I'm going to say happy Ramadan virtually to everyone and, you know, say the same thing and not having ability to go outside after, you know, during futur or after. Jeez, I never thought it was going to take this long, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really. I feel like people are I'm getting tired of it. I feel like I'm stressing. I'm just tired of having curfews and tired of not having this ability to like go after futur or go get coffee or sit somewhere in a cafe.
Yeah.
We have to give them more advice on what to do now, just the same thing we did last year.
In general though, Dr. D, like what have you noticed in terms of people's moods in Ramadan? Is it elevated or is it low?
I feel like they're more anxious. I mean, they were always like, you know, before they were like, to be honest, it's like, you know, their sleep pattern is not good. So therefore, they don't feel like they have a lot of energy. They can't think about many things. Their routine has definitely changed. But now with COVID, you know, they're already feeling anxious. They're already feeling down. There's a sense of loss because either they've lost somebody or they've lost their job or, you know, kids that haven't been able to graduate the way they wanted or small kids haven't been able to go to school. I just feel like their mood... Going from COVID and being anxious to now being in Ramadan, and what would that mean for them? I feel like a lot of people are struggling, to be honest.
So what's a good way to channel all of that? Like, would it make sense to find something that they can control within this chaos?
Of course. And that's one of the things I constantly talk about is that, you know, we tend to spend a lot of time talking about things like we can't control, like I'm doing now, curfew, COVID, you know. So instead of, I have to make the best out of the situation. And I think people need to start learning, how can you make the best out of situation? And how can, what can you do to apply specific things in your life that you're in control of? Like, you're in control of your eating, you're in control of how you sleep, you're in control of your routine. Yes, the situation is not the best and none of us like it, but instead of sitting there and complaining about it, what can you do to feel a little bit in control? And that's what I think people should concentrate on.
I think you said something very important earlier when you said sleep. And I think people mess up their sleep so much during Ramadan. And then they, you know, they hit that wall of, and I'm going to jump into the whole, you know, exercise and dieting and trying to lose weight during Ramadan, because I think that's always a hot topic amongst people. And, you know, they'll go to their nutritionist and their nutritionist will usually put them on a huge caloric deficit of like 800 or 900 calories, which is stupid anyways, because the body can't really survive on it. And then you just shut down your metabolism. Your metabolism's already slowed from the intermittent fasting that you're doing from, what, 4 a.m. to about 6 p.m. So, you know, going and slowing your metabolism down even more by creating more of a caloric deficit is just, you know, it's not the smartest thing you can do. But what people don't understand is sleep definitely impacts our weight loss and our hormonal levels during a prolonged period of time. And I think people really need to emphasize on the importance of sleep during that time, because they're like, oh, why don't I lose weight? Why don't I lose weight? Well, it's simple. You're going to have insulin spikes. Your body's going to be out of whack. You're going to want to eat more carbs because you're tired. And then when you hit that futur time and you jump into the rice, the tashriba, the marguga, the whatever you have it, that's when you're going to go extremely carb heavy. And then you're going to crave more carbs throughout the night. And you're going to go into the sweets and jumping into all of that stuff and then staying up late again. And then, oh, hey, has got her hand up.
May I play devil's advocate here?
Go right ahead. I knew you were going to do this. I knew I was walking into a trap.
You're not necessarily walking into a trap. And Dr. D, you can give your input on this as well.
He always thinks that he's attacked and there's...
No, listen.
I told you to sit by the door, woman.
Hey, you have to come and sit next to him. We will not allow a woman to sit on the floor by the door.
Oh, no, I'm on the bed. I'm very comfortable right now.
If she's too close, the sound will bleed.
So I understand the whole idea of like wanting to lose weight and all that other stuff. But lately, I've also been thinking of different ways to think about food. And especially food in Ramadan, it becomes this experience with family and friends. And people look forward to this month. So what if, like, it's more about just changing the mindset of food in terms of, I can't have this and I can't have this and I can't have that, but I'm choosing to enjoy this time and this food with my family and mindfully eating it.
100%.
Because that's
agree
different
with you.
Than gorging as opposed to having an experience with it, right?
No, you're right. You're right. And if you set the habit right, I think when you go into a diet and it doesn't work for the first week or it's so hard, you set the parameters so unachievable, right, Dr. D? As soon as you realize that it's unachievable to maintain for the period of 30 days, what happens? You crash and burn. And I think if we set achievable goals, it's a lot easier.
I mean, I understand that people are like, you know, starving by the time futur comes and then they have to eat. But I also think that people need to start thinking logically that, you know, instead of concentrating on what food I'm going to have and how much of it I should have, is that they should pace themselves. And I mean, that's your guys' area. But the idea is that pacing yourself and trying to enjoy this food while you are with your family, especially families, you know, it's COVID, so they're not going to be able to have all the family around, just like last year. And they're going to do it with less family. But the idea is that I'm going to enjoy conversation with family, that I don't need to like eat everything by half an hour or 15 minutes. And then after that, having a stomach ache. And most people like will eat and then they want to go work out or go walking. I guess now we can walk from 7 to 10. But I feel like this is where routine really plays a part. And also because they're staying up so late and they're eating so late, then of course they're going to sleep in late, or they have to wake up to go to work, which they're tired also. So if everything is surrounding food, not really the meaning of what Ramadan is, then of course they're going to, you know, overeat. And I'm not sure, is it true that people really lose weight in Ramadan? I can't imagine people are losing weight in Ramadan.
Personally, I 4 years ago, you remember?
Do people really lose?
I actually lost weight during Ramadan 4 years ago. Do you remember when we went to my grandmother's and I used to bring my food with me? And even Bedriya asked me once, she goes, did you really bring your food to your grandmother's? And I was like, yeah. But that's different. I had a very specific goal during that month, and it had nothing to do with Ramadan and everything to do with the bigger picture of, you know, trying to achieve good health during that month and the intermittent fasting and what I was eating afterwards. And I didn't gorge. I mean, hey, I saw what I used to bring. I didn't gorge, and I never felt the feeling of being starving. In fact, I always kind of ate less during Futur, and I would really eat more towards the end of the night. I'd have like a very, not heavy meal, probably around 1,000 to, you know, 1,500 calorie meal to sustain me throughout the day. I stayed away from heavy meat, especially salty things, because that's going to obviously make you thirsty the next day. And I kind of stuck to chicken and, you know, rice and whatever else. And hey, Dr. Lee, this is the hard part. Hey is over there. And she's making faces and stuff.
I'm not
And she's making me fumble
faces.
All my words. That's not fair. That is not fair.
I am listening intently. Continue.
Intently.
I am listening.
So basically, I was able to achieve specific goals, but they were specific. And they were small steps leading to a bigger step.
So goals are important, see?
100%. 100%.
Yeah, but that means that goals are important. And I think people spend a lot of time, like now I have people like, oh my God, it's Ramadan, you know, and we already have curfew and I don't know if I'm going to fast and I don't know if I want to fast. Like, why are people so concentrating on all the things that they see as negative? Look, if you're going to make a decision that you're going to fast, you need to be able to do it willingly. You have to understand the reason why you're doing it, and you have to be able to keep your schedule the way it is. You should not be sleeping at 6 a.m. and then, you know, skipping. Like now, I'm sure my students are going to be skipping. They're not going to attend, or they're going to attend and not talk, which makes it very difficult to have a class. And all of this in the name of, like, you cannot believe how many of my students make excuses. Well, dog, it is Ramadan and you know how it is. And no, I don't know how it is, because actually it's a commitment you have made. And that commitment requires that you keep the same schedule. You see, you know, I understand people need to sleep late, and I understand that they are, you know, they have to eat their last meal about 3 a.m, correct? I still feel like people need to stop trying to use Ramadan as an excuse for their lack of activity and use it as a way to motivate them and to use it as a challenge to keep their routine and their goals going. Goals shouldn't stop just because 1 month, you know, people eating habit has changed, or that they have to do these spiritual, you know, events that they need to do. You're doing it because you want to. That's a choice.
Yeah, yeah. What's your choice this Ramadan, here?
Well, we're talking about goals. And I think that it also matters just like the type of goals that you set.
That's true. Realistic goals.
Yeah. And also, it's a month. And so within this month, you can have multiple little things that you want to keep, like maintaining a schedule and making sure that you're being a bit more mindful while you're eating. And I think all these little things are just going to eventually add up and make for a better experience. Because I've been guilty of this in the past, where just like the month before Ramadan, I just start freaking out, thinking, how am I going to survive? Especially in the summer. And I think also just when you start getting very obsessive about it before it even happens, it's just not the healthiest.
No, I think it's not the healthiest. And also, as you said, your goals should be specific. You know, I think people should look at Ramadan this year and say, what have I learned about myself? What can I learn during this month? You know, if being spiritual this month is your goal, then stick to that. Like, don't lose focus. If, you know, I'm going to increase my exercises, or I'm going to eat the right food and not like, or inhale all the food right away, making it more specific, or like, you know, Mahdi, you're saying I had my own food. I knew what I wanted to eat. These things are very, very important. But people start putting unrealistic goals. It's like what we do in Lent and also when we fast for Christmas, right? Before Christmas.
Yeah.
It's like this like unexpectation that I'm going to do this. I'm going to give up this. And then you fall. Or like people when they do it for New Year's Eve, right? New Year's goals for the new year. And then people set up so high expectation. And then when they fail so bad. And I don't really think you should do that. Your body gets adjusted to whichever goal you've set up.
100%. And that's the thing. Your body will always find its homeostasis. It will always find its happy spot. And you need to get into an uncomfortable position the right way in order to see, you know, achievable changes. With that said, I think one of the things, and hey, I saw me do this a couple of years ago. I was a class chaser in the gym. You know, a lot of people, a few years ago, you know, like it would be after Fatur and, you know, we're always strapped on time. So instead of, you know, doing my normal routine, I do like a CrossFit class, then I jump into a spin class. And then, you know, it would be like after that, I'd be like, all right, well, let's go for a walk or whatever. And I was doing way too much heavy working out after Fatur, and it wasn't sustainable. I ended up, I ended up getting really sick.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got really sick, I think 2 weeks into it because my body just broke down. It was like, dude, what are you doing? You're putting me through 2-3 hours of vigorous exercise. And in a class format, you go a little bit harder because of the people and the environment. I mean, I saw at least 3 guys that would be like, yeah, dude, are you doing spin class too? Yeah, I'm doing CrossFit too. Oh yeah, let's do all 3 of these classes together. And it's like, all right, even if you're doing them half an hour increments, you know, like a half an hour for this class, half an hour for that class, you're putting your body through a lot of stress after it had already been stressed for the whole day of fasting without water, mind you. So the better thing to do, in my opinion, that I do now is do some, you know, mobility and then go into my workout, probably work out around 80%, maybe even 70%, depending on the day. Because you can't overstress your body. You do that, it's just a recipe for disaster. And like we said earlier, you have to look for what is going to be sustainable over a 30-day or a 28-day period. And a lot of the times, like unfortunately, people just kind of overdo it. So what mindset do you guys think people can plan out? I mean, usually I have a plan. You know, right now I'm going to the CrossFit quarterfinals for the Masters, and I have a plan over the next 4 weeks of how I'm going to attack that with my coach. We talked about it. So I have a plan going into it. And it's like with Ramadan, I also have a plan for Ramadan and what I'm going to do, how my training is going to look, how my day is going to look, what time I'm going to wake up. And I've planned that a week in advance to try and make sure that I can sustain that over, you know, the long period of time because, A, you know, my sport won't allow me to, you know, kind of relax a little bit during that month, especially with the quarterfinals. So I think people really should write it out and, you know, kind of lay it all out there so that they have those, you know, achievable goals that they can strive for, whether it is physical, spiritual, or whatnot. I mean, people need to have like a little bit of a roadmap going into it.
No, and I do believe that these, like, you know, if you write up these your goals. I think also you need to stop thinking about, I'm not drinking, I'm not eating, Ramadan is this. The thing is that these are discussions you can have with your psychiatrist. Most of my clients, for example, take their medication. I don't know if I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. And then they become so exaggerated in their head. And what happened is that they will fail. They're not going to be able to fast, or they're going to fast a couple of days and then they won't make it. And then they feel upset. Or they have to pretend that they have to tell people that I'm fasting when they're not. Like, you know, it's like people really need to be able to go with their own pace. And then they have to realize that this is just a month and it's not something that they have to kind of concentrate about. Oh my God, you know, these are all the obstacles I'm going to have in this month. How about all the things you could learn? First of all, you know, I mean, all the research says these like intermittent fasting really does work. And actually, I was just reading an article that fasting helps with aging, and people that fast on a regular time, not just for this month, but other times, they tend to, you know, have less wrinkles. They can preserve a lot of their aging symptoms. So really, there's a lot of good things about people that fast. Now the idea is that maybe you should look at, you know, like you said, like the goals or the sleep. Definitely, I feel like people should not use Ramadan as an excuse to not be able to sleep and sleep in the way that they should be sleeping. Definitely. And I feel like people don't do that.
Yeah, no, 100%. And I think the bigger thing for me is looking at it when you talk about the fasting and the intermittent fasting. And one of the issues I see with that, because it's a very hot thing in the diet and the fitness world right now. And I think the most important thing to remember is that there is a process to it. And one of the processes is doing it right and understanding what you need to do to break your fast. And usually when people intermittent fast, they'll break their fast with a bone broth or something light. My great-grandmother, God rest her soul, she lived a very long life, alhamdulillah. And, you know, I think because she fasted a lot, you know, she did Ramadan. And then I think every Monday and Tuesday she would fast. And she didn't break her fast by eating tashriba, rice, and crazy things. She didn't do all that crazy shit. She actually was very mindful of what she broke her fast with. And it was always like, you know, shorbat ades, and like, it was always tamar, shorbat ades. And it was lighter things. And thinking about it, I never really remember her, you know, destroying herself after fasting. And she would always pray. Like, her first thing would be, like, let me drink some water, tamra, go and pray right away. And, you know, she did this my whole life. I remember it vividly as a kid growing up. And then she'd be the last one to pretty much sit at the dinner table to break her fast. And she would eat like a little bit. And, you know, this was maybe into her, from what I remember, well into her 70s and through her 80s. And, you know, I think like a lot of her longevity was probably from fasting, but she did it the right way.
Sure.
People go and they do intermittent fasting and then they think, oh, I'm intermittent fasting. Okay, this gives me the right to binge. Or they'll do the, I'll eat 1,800 calories to sustain me and then I'll intermittently fast. And that's the wrong way of doing it. And it's just, you really have to do the research before you do it and understand your body and its needs before you go into something like that.
But it all comes down to intention as well.
100%, yeah.
So like if you're going into fasting thinking, oh my goodness, I have to do this, it's a chore. Of course, there's a feeling of binging afterwards because you feel like you have to not eat anything throughout the day. So when you can eat, you're just going to eat everything in sight, as opposed to thinking this month is a special month. And I'm going to fully immerse myself in it the right way. That shift in mindset from have to, I get able to experience this, will do a lot for that. Because then you're not going to binge at the end of it because you know it's not about the food. It's about so many other things. And once you come to that realization, if you want to come to that realization, it changes it.
No, 100%.
Yeah, I mean, and I think you're right. I think when people should not look at Ramadan as a time where I'm going to eat all these food that I don't eat. By the way, they have like the best the best food during the month. 100%. It is so true. But also the idea is that not you know, because there are so many food that doesn't come out any other time except during Ramadan, which is fine. But if you can just like, you know, it's supposed to also, I mean, what is the purpose of Ramadan? It's supposed to be something spiritual. It's a family connection, being able to eat together. Actually, I know a lot of families from my clients, they will not eat together throughout the year, but during Ramadan, they do sit together, which is to emphasize on the purpose of, or look at, I'm going to spend time with my family. I'm going to become more spiritual. Maybe I'm going to get rid of some of these habits that I've been doing throughout the year that I shouldn't be doing, or, you know, stop engaging in activities or addictions that I shouldn't be engaging. So this is a time we're really making some changes. So maybe if people can concentrate on that, then they will be less concentrating on how much food they're going to have when they do eat. And therefore, they don't have to feel guilty. Or that's why I think that, to be honest, I think a lot of people gain weight. They don't lose weight during Ramadan if they're not doing it correctly.
100%.
Yeah. And it's a choice. Again, it's a choice. A lot of people act like their whole life is not a choice. Everything we do is a choice.
Speaking of, I mean, I got the quarterfinals. You think God will forgive me if I don't fast so I can train?
Mehdi.
You think God will forgive me? He's forgiven. Most gracious, most merciful.
He's forgiven.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, doesn't quarterfinals like qualify you for like an exemption or something?
Blasphemy.
I'm just asking. I'm not being blasphemous. I'm just saying I need an exemption here.
Again, it's a choice. Again, it's something that you have to deal with. You and God have to deal with it. Yeah. But also, I think this teaches you something about how much you can handle and what are the, you know, be a little bit more self preserve this teaches you like new skills that you got to see if you can do that.
No, of course. And I'll probably just end up doing my quarterfinals at night because it starts on May 3rd, which is the tail end of Ramadan. So I'm going to be doing I'm going to be doing my quarterfinals at night and trying to sustain over the month. I'll be all right. You know, that mixed in with my mom's tishriba, my mother's marguga, because she's here now and probably eating a lot of jadish. Have you ever tried jadish, Dr. D?
I love jadish.
It's amazing. Do you eat it with...
I buy by the jamaiya guy. Is that the same thing? Do they taste the same thing?
No,
the jamaiya guy. There's a jamaiya guy that's...
I'm going to bring you some of my mama's jadish. That stuff's awesome. She makes it with chicken. I like it with chicken better than the lamb.
Oh, no, they make it with chicken also. I don't know. It always tastes good. You know, the guy that's like the al-khabaz, and then there's one...
Oh, yeah. The guy that has like naqi and bajilla and that stuff.
I get it from there. Does that count?
No, that definitely does count. Hey, what's the green stuff that I usually eat?
Not malakhiya.
Yeah, that green stuff. He also sells it.
No, there's like this green...
Ash. That's right.
That stuff, that gives you like... That's like power right there. That stuff's like power out.
You have yet to tell me what it is made of.
I have no idea what's in there. I have absolutely no clue what is in there. It's just like a hodgepodge of like... I don't even know. But that stuff, like, that sets me off. That and shebzi. You ever eat marak shebzi?
Yes, I have, of course.
I love shebzi. Good shebzi. You can't go wrong with good shebzi. Shebzi's awesome.
So your mom can cook all of this?
Oh, yeah. My mom could cook Arabic, Italian.
Whoa.
You name it. She's Mexican. She can make it all. Like, my mama can cook anything. Legit.
And she learned all these Arabic Kuwaiti dishes when she married your dad?
Yeah, my great-grandmother came to Boston when I was like 4 or 5.
Okay.
And she stayed with us for a month, and my mother picked it all up really fast. That was the first time I had marak batat, and then my mother would make marak batat after it. And, you know, of course, and my great-grandmother, God rest her soul, Allah yarhamha, she made the best marak batat, okay? And she used to make marak qima, and I love qima. It's like a lentil. That was my all-time like favorite food. Like, I could eat a huge pan of it, like, no tomorrow, easily.
I wonder, for Ramadan, where can I order all that stuff? I'm sure that they're going to be...
My mom, she'll make it. I'll tell her.
Oh, Mom? I don't know about Mom.
I won't tell her it's for you.
I just don't tell her it's for me.
I'll tell it's for someone else.
Tell it's for Haya.
I know, right? All right, so last words before ending this Ramadan series. You know, this is our third Ramadan series. We've been around for 3 years. We've been around for a long time.
Yeah, that's right. And two of them have been COVID.
I know, that's such a bummer. But we will hit 100,000, I think, over 100,000 downloads soon, which is amazing.
Good job.
I know, right?
That's because, you know, Hey is with us and me, and it's on you have nothing to do with it.
I know. She tips us over.
The 100%. We do it all.
It's the women on this podcast. Last thought. I really want to all our listeners to really pay attention to your sleep, because when your sleep is changed, your mood changes, you're putting yourself at risk of anxiety, panic, depression. And then it's so hard to pick up after the month is over. So I know it's difficult. I know people have to sleep so late, but there are other people that don't sleep. They'll sleep at 11, 12, still the same thing. Sleep is so important. And it's like the main component of our mental health.
Hey,
be mindful, especially when with family and friends at the dinner table. Enjoy it. Don't indulge in it, but enjoy it and be mindful of it.
100%. And I am on the exact same page as you. Enjoy it. Enjoy the month of Ramadan. Enjoy the experiences you're going to have, the love you're going to feel, and everything that comes along with it, including the food. Have a great time. And, you know, treat it like anything else in life. If you overdo it, you're going to suffer consequences. So keep it within reason. And if you're looking to exercise, find something you find enjoyment in to exercise. Don't just do it because you want to burn stupid calories and look at your dumb watch. Just go out there, play soccer, play with your kids, basketball, running, walking. Find a new hobby, for Christ's sake. I think that's one of the important things to do, is just enjoy the month of Ramadan. You have a lot of time on your hands. You know, work is cut short. and you have more time. Dr. D's raising her hand. I'm just going to keep talking. I'm going to keep talking through this one, Dr. D. Go ahead, Dr. D.
I think that the idea is that we really need to enjoy, because there are going to be people that we might have Ramadan with this year that we might not have them the next Ramadan. Or there are people that are already have gone from our life that we didn't really take the time to enjoy being with them. So I think when you're saying that, it's like this month also brings family together, and mm-hmm. you never know if they're going to be with us again, or especially elderly, or, you know, your elder parents or grandparents or whatever. I think you should just learn to enjoy them, because you never know how long they're going to be lasting.
No, and that's true. I mean, my cousin Hela, she was, and I hate saying this on air because she can hold me to this, like every Ramadan, she was the focal point of everything. And she was, you know, such a great person to have with us. And then she moved to Dubai afterwards. And I haven't had a Ramadan with her in a while. And, you know, I miss that part. I miss that family aspect of it. And you're right. I mean, we might have Ramadan with someone we love now, and then they're not here next year. So, yeah, it's a good point, Dr. D. That's a really good point. And everybody, if you have any questions during the holy month of Ramadan that has nothing to do with religion, please send us a DM. Because we don't talk religion or politics on the show. So send us a DM if it has to do with mindset or dieting or exercise or any of the above. Even recipes, I could get you some good recipes from my mama. No problem whatsoever. You know, I'm trying to get her to use brown oats, or, you know, like healthier versions for the meals. She won't do it. She's like, it will taste like...
She won't?
No, she said it will taste horrible.
It won't taste the same, I don't think.
I don't know.
I think I like these traditional classical recipes. She's right.
I know. I got the quarterfinals to worry about.
You can't eat her food then, or eat less, right? You can eat less.
For portions.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. That ain't going to happen. That's definitely not happening.
Then that's your own fault. Nobody else's.
I don't mind. I'll just turn into a power lifter, and then I can actually eat whatever I want.
Excuse me.
Oh, you heard me. You heard me over there sitting by the door. Anyways, thank you everybody for listening to this episode, and we definitely hope you all have a wonderful month of Ramadan.
Happy Ramadan!
Thanks for listening to this episode. If you enjoyed it, please head over to iTunes to subscribe, rate, and leave a review. You can also find us on Instagram @ The Project Thank You, and join us next time.